So we come to the end of the day, 21st of October, going into the 22nd. And what happened on the 21st? Well, nothing spectacular, just a steady stream of insight, steady stream of clarification. That's all. Just a nice, steady, clear stream. And, you know, I've managed to not struggle with too much of it. Just wow, 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 wow. And the whole day was just this wow of clarification. But as far as, you know, spectacular stuff or nothing, just an ordinary day. And really just a one of, you know, an endless succession of ordinary days, really. And yet reacting to the insight, just instead of, oh, this is it, or this, I like this, or I don't like this, or yes or no, just wow. I just leave it at that. This is really the key to, you can have, the day can be a stream of great insight, which is what happened today, actually. It's still happening. And I just said, okay, that wow. Not yes, not no, not yes, not no, neither yes nor no. And when you do this, the insights come faster and faster and faster, because you're not stopping them by saying, now, wait a minute, you know, what does this mean? Or what do I need to do next? Or think, no, just wow. Okay. And this open, it keeps the door open for more insights to come. Now, it is important to state that success doesn't come the way of from attainment, learning, answers, anything like that. It only comes through familiarity. That's it. Familiarity wins. Familiarity is decisive. Familiarity is decisive. Familiarity is decisive. Interesting, right? This separates the dilettantes from the ones who ultimately succeed. The dilettante is looking for answers. Those who succeed are looking for familiarity. This is why when something comes up, you don't grab it like an answer. Oh, I got the answer. You just say, wow. Okay, let me just allow that to become part of my familiarity. This is the discipline, the mental discipline. Now, I understood today what the term master means. It means master the mind. They say someone who's mastered the mind. And we don't think that's possible, but maybe it is possible. I mean, ultimately, we would say the egoic mind doesn't exist. But the idea of having the discipline in your mind to go to the wow instead of dualistic categories of right and wrong, you know, of success and not success, and trying to grab it in some way. Don't grab it. This is part of mastery of the mind, I guess you would say. And you want to write it down too. You say, oh my gosh, this is like a pearl of wisdom. Let me record it. Let me write it down. Let me grab a hold of it. And let me put it into some format, some definition. No, just let it remain as it is. See, you know, seemingly partly formless, you know, it's just let it be that way and don't chase after it. Don't chase it. Just stay still and just say, wow. Don't go chasing after butterflies. Let them come to you. When you're still, the butterflies will come to you, and then you just stay still, and they try to get you to chase after them. And you just say, wow, butterflies coming up to me. Wow. We don't say, well, what does it mean? What can I do with it? Where should I go with this? What, you know, measuring it, planning, projecting, just, no, don't do any of that. Just say, wow. What an experience. Wow, this is really a tense experience. Wow. And then more butterflies come. So, you know, your day is full of these beautiful butterflies, and you just say, wow, there's another one. Wow, there's another one. Okay. Wow, I just had an insight that's absolutely crucial. Great. I couldn't tell you what it is right now because I'm in the wow, sort of. Because it's, that's what enables familiarity to set in. It has to set in. Familiarity has to really set in. It's not anything we can get as an answer. It's an overall. It's an overall. And even that, we don't have an answer or definition for it. Just stay in the wow. Don't grab for a definition. Say, well, what is non-dual? Non-dual is not just... Non-dual is wow. You could. What is non-dual? It's wow. Yeah. When we're practicing correctly and focusing on just the wow, this is when all the popcorn starts popping. Had a lot of popcorn pop today. So what's important is say, I still feel fine, everything's great, it's not a problem. It the familiarity setting in with it, I feel like when it have insights like that again, I just say, oh, there's a very familiar friend. I see this friend every day, you know, many times a day. So it's like that. You see someone many times a day, you get familiar with them. If you see them once a month, not so much. Many times a day. So don't go chasing after butterflies. This is really important. Just keep sitting still. Just whenever, if you're driving, wherever you are, the insight. Just keep exactly what you're doing, where you're at with it, and just notice it, look at it, and aha! Great! Wow! That's really a fantastic insight. Wow. You'll feel that. Wow, what a great insight. And you do it that way, another one comes. You do it that way, another one comes. You do it that way, another one comes. They keep coming and coming and coming. You just keep noticing it. Okay, I notice that. I see that. I'm fine. Don't think, oh my gosh, I lost it. That's so important. You know, more important ones keep coming, actually. This is how it goes. I mean, the insights get better and better and better and better and better. And don't assess where you are on the path. Just say, well, right now it's just wow, and I know this is because of great progress. So right now that's where it's at. So nothing spectacular today. Jesus didn't say, hey, take notes. This is our, didn't show up or, you know, there's just nothing. It was just a normal blah day, but great, great insight as I kept working with the mind and watched a little baseball. Congratulations to the Mets are going to the World Series. Watched some of that. On and off, kind of going in and then coming back just a little bit, that kind of thing. But other than that, then quickly off. So okay, you know, that's. You don't have to be completely draconian. You know, you can occasionally just take a peek at something if you have to, if you want to. But stay away from news, the media, and all that kind of stuff now. So don't go searching when you're in the wow. Don't go saying, how can I, let me see now, well, how, what did I think today? And just trust it. You already saw it. When you see it, you see it. You know, in other words, believe that you saw it. If you see the insight, believe it. Don't say, I'm not sure I really had that insight. Did I really have that insight? And then try to go back and remember it. No, just say, yeah, I did have that insight. This is part of my home, so to speak. Part of my familiarity. I don't need to second guess. Don't second guess yourself. Just have faith in what you saw. It's true. You know, when you saw it, you knew it was true. You say, oh, this is truth. And then later on, you try to say, well, wait a minute. Was it really true? Let me go back and look at it again. Don't do that. So a lot of pearls of wisdom today, lots of them, very, very heavy, wonderful stuff. And then when you're in the wow, don't struggle to say, oh, did I, you know, what did I say today? What, you know, was it? No, you just trust it. Okay, it's like money in the bank. You know, you put the money in the bank. Do you have to go keep going back to the bank and checking and say, wait a minute, is the money in there? I'm not sure the money is in there. You get all freaked out. Is it? No, I know I put it in there. Just because tomorrow, you know, you'll put some more in and you realize, okay. Who knows? Who knows what is next? We don't really know. The insights just come out of the blue. They've been just like, they're tremendous. I said, oh, I've never seen that before. Absolutely wonderful. So who knows what will come up next? So it's good to just say, yeah, I had the insights today, and don't struggle, because this helps familiarity. So I don't need to go back over them again. I got it the first time. And you can say, well, I'm a superstar. Now, stars, of course, have to do with electromagnetic universe, which is... don't even want to go there. To say superstars is not, we're not talking about electromagnetism and everything that we try to do with it. But even that, I already saw that. Don't need to dig into that. It's like if you eat something, don't throw it up to see what you ate. I think that's a good analogy. You eat a big meal and say, wow, that's great. And then suddenly, after a while, you start, wait a minute, what did I have tonight? Did I really eat that? I'm not sure that I have that and that, or I don't know. I'm not sure if it was that. It probably was, I'm not sure. So what do? You go gag yourself and throw it all up on your plate and say, oh, yeah, I see some pieces there. That's not what we want to do. But I think that's a great analogy, because that's pretty much what we're doing. We're just throwing it up, so we're not digesting it. Let the digestive process work. Now, I know it seems to go slow, but it goes a lot slower when you don't do it the right way. In fact, then it goes so slow you end up quitting. So we're going as fast as possible, but even, you know, but still, we have to have this patience. This is the way to go fast. So when you're sitting quietly, you don't always have to, you know, it has to be all full of insight and everything. Maybe you just had so much insight during the day, you need to spend some time in the wow, just recognizing this. I think this is super important. Every time I get stuck is because I actually have had so much insight, I forgot to recognize the wow, and so I start struggling. As soon as I say, hey, maybe I'm just having, you know, experiencing this really intense, you know, feeling a wow, then everything changes. It's amazing. It's like, it really is a miracle. I stop struggling and being upset, and start having gratitude and confidence. Gratitude and confidence return and say, oh yeah, this wow is the result of tremendous success I've been having. So I said, get plugged back into confidence, inner confidence. Now, the mind has had its way with us. We say the mind, what does that mean? Well, we won't dig into that, but let's just, for the purposes of talking, it's had its way with us and has been bossing us and bullying us. So it's quite something to just say no to the mind. We're just going to just focus on the wow. There's really no mental activity taking place with the wow. And not trying to reach some outcome, mental outcome. So we don't have to always hit a home run. We can have many, many, many little hits, and they add up during the day. Speaking of hits, I will say something that came to my attention today. This is how I got clued into it. A friend of ours had a big rock hit their windshield today. A stone, a big stone. As soon as I heard that, I said, stoned. She was stoned. Wait a minute. I said, let me go back to that dream I had of the three collapses of the rocks and the stones rolling out all over the place. First one bad, the second one worse, the third one incalculably worse. And what was everything? Stones going everywhere. Everyone was inundated with these stones. They got stoned, severely stoned. Everyone drastically, severely stoned in the third one. And I said, wait a minute. I've already identified these as likely episodes of rampant drug use. You see, it's interesting that people in a large scale throughout history were not rampant drug users. This is a modern thing. Maybe the distribution and all, I don't know. There's a lot of reasons for it. But I'm sure they drank their ale and beer and, you know, whatever. But really, if you go through history, you don't hear all these. Well, I mean, the opium in China was something that the British intentionally, East India Company, British intentionally fostered this. Intentionally got as many people addicted as possible for profits. That's a little different story. But in it, you know, how about just people knowingly and willfully going into a drug epidemic? Well, we had one in the 20s, the roaring 20s, jazz age and that kind of stuff, and everyone was jazzed up and on cocaine, and not everyone, but you know, it was really that was the mood. And then we had one in the 67 and 70s and 80s, but it got real bad in the 80s. Late 70s and 80s, and crack cocaine in the mid 80s. So that was a terrible, terrible drug epidemic. I remember it very well, and living in quite a tremendous amount of fear, actually. I said, this, you know, it was a feeling. It's really weird when so many people are on heavy drugs or something, you know, it you get a feeling. So that was the second epidemic. Everyone was very stoned, heavily stoned, you might say. Well, in the dream, the third one, people were so heavily stoned by that, it was just off the charts. You could not believe how strong that was. I had to flee from it. It was just, and people were just in a daze. I saw them, they're all in a daze. They're like just incredibly stoned. So maybe there's another drug coming down the river here, or, well, there's new drugs all the time, aren't there? The people are just constantly trying to find more and more ways to get stoned. So evidence is pointing in this direction, that there's going to be a third drug epidemic. From the 2020, And the pacing is similar. See, though, the pacing is similar to what the dream I had. This is what gets my attention. From the 20s to the 70s, it'll be 50 years. From the 70s to where we are now is, if we start from 20 to 70 is 50. From 70 to here is 45, where we're at. 45, actually. Wow. Quite similar, huh? Now, there's some people who believe if you go to 65, or 67, it's the same. From 20 to 67, 67 to 205, it's pretty much the same, actually. 20 to 66 is 46, and 70 to 215 is 45. Twenty to 70 is 50, and 45, so 70, 68, be around like 68, wouldn't it? That'd be 58, and I mean 48 and 47. 68, so 67 and a half would be an equal point starting from 1920. Wow. Yeah, that hits right on the head hits the head on the nail, doesn't it? At that time, the drug epidemic really in the, you know, 67 Summer of Love in San Francisco, where this is where drugs became extremely popular, and the whole drug culture took off in the middle of 67, exactly in the intermediate point between 1920 and 2015. And that came about, you know, hey, wow. Well, of course, you know, it was, what was it, Albert Hoffman or whoever, Sandoz lab, synthesizing the LSD, been around for quite some time, but it began to be distributed more and more and more and more and more than other derivatives, artificial, you know, mescaline and then ethnogens and psilocybin and a lot of different types of speed and a lot of stuff was just flooded with drugs. And this starting in, you know, 67, yeah. That's when they had the free clinic in the Haight-Ashbury, San Francisco. There's so many people overdosing on drugs, they just had lines. I mean, they had to treat them for free. They didn't have any money. There were kids. There were kids that were overdosing. Runaways, you know, just all sorts of different kids that didn't have any money at all, but they somehow got held to drugs and took way too many. So when Augustus Owsley Stanley III began distributing, you know, acid, orange sunshine in the Bay Area, and of course down the Brotherhood of Eternal Love down in Southern California, Laguna area, they were distributing it down there heavily. This was new. I mean, it caught everybody. This drug thing catches everybody by surprise. Okay, this is what we have to understand. The various drugs that were coming in then, most kids had no idea what this stuff was. Well, you know. It's like, what is this? So, wow, they all said, well, it's an alternative to alcohol. You look at your parents, a bunch of drunken fools, you know. You don't want to be like them, do you? This stuff, man, this will make you really, really high. It's much better than alcohol. And so the kids want to be sophisticated like their parents, but they didn't really want to, you know, you'd say, well, the parents are like, look at them, get drunk, what fools they are. This will make you sophisticated and smart. Kids are suckers for it. But the point I'm getting at, now, we can talk about how much social engineering was involved in all this, and I would say it was mostly social engineering involved with this, actually. Same thing as it grew into the 70s and then the 80s. This is a big rollout, and the dream, that the first one didn't last that long, the stones coming down. The second one was much bigger and lasted longer. Then the third was just catastrophic. So what I'm getting at is, who knows what kind of drug is just around the corner? See, we assume that we've seen it all. We assume, oh yeah, you know, we got booked. It's got every, you know, list all the various drugs available. There's so many. But that just shows you how many drugs have been developed in the last 50, 45 years, right? I mean, just derivatives of everything. There's so many. But, so, if we're developing new drugs constantly, which is the case, how do we know that there isn't some drug just around the corner? Or a bunch of them, just around the corner. How do we know that isn't, you know, that'll just take the world by storm? And I would bet on it at this point. You know what? I would bet on it. I'd say it's a very good bet from what I've been able to determine. I would say somewhere somebody knows about it. Something's going on. And it will be like the miracle drug that will make people, you know, less aggressive and happy and less industrious and, you know, on and on and on. And I bet you at some point it'll be legalized. They'll say, hey, you know, we finally come up with this miracle drug. And the world will say, we need this, we need this, we really need this. And they'll fast track it somehow. I mean, this is social engineering. I mean, how much of the past 70 years have been socially engineered? I'd say almost all of it. Almost all of it. And I would say the future, coming up in the future, is going to, why should we just assume that it's finished? That we've seen the worst of it? Why should we assume that? See, this is an interesting question to ask of ourselves. Have they come up with all the best drugs already? I mean, there's nothing else new under the sun? Is that true? I'd say that'd be a very naive assumption, not based on any of the progressions that have taken place already. I mean, you know, mathematically, you couldn't be happy with such an equation. You say, okay, it just flat line just stops here. I mean, what is in the equation that indicates that? Because there's a greater need for social engineering now than there ever has been, and I guarantee that the level of social engineering now is vastly more sophisticated than before. And it's way more prevalent, and it's way more intense, and it has much, much greater urgency. So why in the world should we think that we're not going to get another dose of, catastrophic dose of social engineering involving drugs? We've already been through those in the 20s, but those in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and into the 90s, I mean, that was just insanely terrible. The epidemics and the crime and people losing their mind, and just the overall feeling of everything got super weird. I've talked to people. I say, yeah, it just got so weird. It was horrible. Well, we were in sort of a dry spell, as it were. We have been. Thank God for that. But relatively so, okay. Maybe we've gotten used to it and things have calmed down, okay. But again, what extrapolation could we make to say it's finished, it's over, no more social engineering, when we have this environmental situation that the world constantly bombarded with the belief that we're basically doomed unless we do something drastic? Now, I would say this. It could very well be that we are doomed at the planet. It could be. I would say that if you want to get things, heal how things are, get it back to, prevent it, try to prevent it, we would have to engage in a very severe policing action, drastic action here in this world, drastic. People would have to be drastically policed. The whole world would have to be. We would have to take emergency. You know, it's like someone overdosing and they're not breathing and they rush to the hospital and they put on life support and they finally bring them back to life, but they almost died. It's kind of like that. We would have to take emergency life support measures in this world and police the heck out of it. The one thing that won't work is half measures. That for sure is not going to work. The other option is, of course, to save ourselves from the world. Instead of trying to save the world, save ourselves from the world. I've talked a lot about, I believe monasticism is the right structure for the world. That would solve the problem right there. However, there's a problem with that. And it's pretty much an unsolvable problem. Because everybody, you could put everybody in a monastic cell and we have a monastic life and we just sit quietly in the room meditating and contemplating and full stop in the wow, like I've done in my life. Pretty much spent my whole life just indoor, in a room, a very monastic life. I still, go outside, move around, but And I spent 15 years pretty much in a room, just go out for something to eat, come back in, and spend all my time. Even had the windows all boarded up, and, you know, it was just like a monastic cell, actually. Okay. Now, in order for us to become non-industrious, remember this whole dream scenario is about outcomes, pursuing outcomes. So in order for us to say, well, I'm not going to pursue any outcomes, we cannot do that. We cannot go cold turkey. It's impossible. Pragmatically impossible. So if we were just stuffed into cells and said, okay, this is, you know, we're all going to just, you know, drastically lower our impact on the environment, what's going to happen is everyone will get severely depressed. Severely depressed. They'll go great. They'll get mentally unstable. Now, unless they find a higher goal than productivity, success, productivity, outcomes, chasing outcomes. They find an outcome which transcends this world. And they say, "Oh, this I want to pursue this outcome. I'm going to be industrious in pursuing this outcome, which is enlightenment." Let's put it, just use that term, whatever term. So realization, realization of inherent immersion, inherent spaciousness, without another, non-dual realization. Pursuing this, you don't go crazy. In fact, you enjoy it. Because this helps you pursue this objective. So, if everyone in the world pursued self-realization, pursued enlightenment, that would solve the environmental problems for sure. This is why I say it, call for a monastic type of world based on a civilization based on monasticism. The only catch is who has the right stuff to even try that, you know, to focus on that. It is very difficult. If everyone was like me, we could do it. It would get done, no question about it. But this isn't the case, because I've already done it. It's not the case. So this would work. What won't work is half measures. Half measures are not going to work. And the United Nations, I don't see how they can possibly take the strict enough measures to actually make it work, given that everyone in the world is still absolutely frantically pursuing outcomes. This is the trouble. So we're in this very, very bad bind, actually. Now, you know, if I want to do something about it, I want to help, so either I'm going to be, you know, policing it or, you know, meditating it. Inquiry. Consideration, wowing it. I'm either going to wow it or I'm going to police it. If I'm going to police it, I'm going to be the worst, most draconian police ever. You know, absolutely, you've got to absolutely make the most intense police state imaginable. You can't even imagine how intense the police state would be. You know, you just crack down on everything. So it's either that or to wow it. And have everybody practicing walking together in the wow. That would work too. That would work better than the police state. But it's likely that people won't do that. So we're headed for a police state, or we're headed for disaster. One of the two. Because the will of the people is just not going to be there in terms of, because they're still desperately chasing outcomes. When you chase outcomes, you're using resources, having an impact, except when you chase the outcome of enlightenment, self-realization, which is, you know, freeing yourself from the world. I mean, another way that would work is just everybody leave the world. Okay, that would work too. Let the world, you know, cool. Let the world settle down, as it were, settle down. Yeah, let's everybody just leave. I would do that too. But I'm not really a policeman. I don't like policing people. Not at all. Rarely do I ever say anything in that regard at all. I let everyone be, you know, as they are. And but, you know, pragmatically, there may be some exceptions. That's fine. It doesn't change the rule at all. Live and let live. Live and let live. Mind my own business and let others mind their own business, you know, and just leave it at that. So policing is not something I want to do. And so, you know, I'm not going to do it. But if I did, I would be extremely severe. You know, and so is there that type of will in the world? You know, it's unlikely, right? It's unlikely. UN, I don't know how they're doing. I didn't check today in Bonn. Checked yesterday, and they did manage to avoid a crisis. A lot of the blocks of countries that are notorious for blocking resolutions because they realize it's a money grab. They want to get as much money as possible. I mean, these third world countries are very shrewd, actually. And they know they've got the leverage right now. They can hold, like bandits, they can hold the whole thing up and say, hey, we won't vote for this unless you give us more money to, you know, the rich countries. So that's the gamesmanship that's going on. They're bartering. But they managed to include, each one gave what they call what we want most. Some sort of declaration of what we want most, and they included those in there, and they're whittling it down. They're getting it ready. They're getting it ready for Paris, and you know, they will come up with something. But I would suggest there's something else around the corner. Now, I noticed something today. This is just how things happen today, insight-wise. I got to this stoplight. I was making a right turn so I could stop and make a right turn. And there's a schoolgirl. I don't know how old, maybe 12 or something. And she comes up to the corner. And I say, okay, she's probably going to walk across the street. But she's looking at her, you know, tablet or something. And she looks up and she says, oh, I can walk. I guess she just glanced up and says, I can walk, because the white walker was on the electronic across the street. So, oh, it says walk. And so she just starts walking. She never looked at the street, at the cars, at her surroundings at all. And I was in the car. I said, gestured. I said, hey, you know, you're responsible for yourself here when you're a pedestrian. But she, no. It's like, I see this all the time, and it's just astonishing to me. And then I recognize something, that they're on this auto, they expect an autopilot society, where if it says I can walk, then I'm entitled to walk. It's an autopilot entitlement society. That they say, I don't need to look at my environment. I'm looking at this screen. And the environment needs to obey my screen. You know? It's astonishing. I mean, every generation up until this one has common sense. This one, there's no common sense there. I mean, who would put a hand over their eyes like this and walk across a street? Even if the signs, you think, well, it's okay, who would actually do that, you know? You look, you see, the cars have stopped. Do they see me? Are they preoccupied? You double check, you reassure someone. But not the younger generation, no. It's like your responsibility is they're involved, so you don't have to even, you know, you're not involved in their life, and just, you're supposed to behave the way they want you to behave. They just don't even have to check on it. It's amazing, so unsafe. But that's not the point. The safety is not the point. What flashed in my mind was I said, oh my God, the young people want an authoritarian society. This is what they are about. And it was just like, yes. Now, how I got to that, it was a gestalt moment, so don't ask me linearly how I got to it. It was just like a kaboom, 360-degree kaboom. They want an authoritarian society. That's what these young people are really about. They just feel that everybody is going to be monitored and going to do exactly what they have to do, and there's no two ways about it. They take no responsibility for themselves. And that, you know, the world's going supposed to take responsibility for them, which is authoritarian society. This is what they want. I saw that, uh-oh. It was that aha moment and then a wow moment. Wow. Finally, we're recognizing what's right in front of our faces. They crave an authoritarian society. They can't function in any other way. They want that, you know, their smartphone to tell them what to do. So we've never had a generation like this that is, I believe, so much wants authoritative control over them, over the world. Authoritarian society. Okay, so this is part of the situation. They're more than willing to throw all their freedoms away, and more than willing. In a free society, you're going to check cars. You're going to check to see, because you say, hey, everybody's free, you know, to do whatever, you know, to the freedom that everyone has is such. I got to make sure they understand, you know, that in this case there's limits to their freedom, and by looking at them, I'm respecting their freedom. Okay, this is a very important point. You know, when I walk across the street, as I did today, actually, I did some walking first time in a long time. I'm checking the cars. I was going across a big boulevard, and there was a left turn that people, right was green, and I was walking across, but the left turn, they can go too, but the cars are supposed to see you. Well, you know, there's a lot of times when I haven't seen a pedestrian in that sort of situation, because you're looking to see if the cars coming towards you are going straight or turning. So you're focused on them, and then you're going, oh, there's the pedestrian. So it's a real tricky thing. So I'm aware of that. I said, hey, this is a tricky situation. So I saw the car in my eye. I saw this car, and it seemed to be slowing down. I said, okay, it looks like they see me. But you know what? I looked at them, and I just sort of raised my hand like that, you know, thanked them. Thanks for stopping, you know. Thanks for stopping. I see you. You see me. Great. This is, so I'm saying, you know, hey, I respect, you know, your freedom. You're absolutely free. I respect your freedom, and I know you're on your way somewhere, and you want to get there, and you have to wait for me. I understand that you probably don't want to. Thanks for seeing me. Thanks for waiting. This is the whole psychological attitude situation that's going on. You recognize their freedom. Thank you for stopping. I know I'm in your way. And I appreciate it, and the driver says, "Hey, you know, I appreciate you're on your way somewhere too. This we all have to get along like this, and this is the, okay, absolutely. This is the fabric of society, fabric of culture. It's an unspoken fabric, actually. You see it in driving, you see it in, you know, in our interaction like this. So, just the difference between the way I was dealing with traffic and the way this schoolgirl was dealing with traffic is just astonishing." She basically said, you don't have any freedom. The light's red, you have no freedom. So I don't even have to acknowledge you at all. This is the way the young people are now. They don't acknowledge the cars. They don't acknowledge people. I mean, it's unbelievable. I do a lot of acknowledgement when I'm driving, where, you know, wherever I go out, yeah, thanks. Okay. And people, you know, you get to a stop sign, you see, you're going straight. There's someone's making a right turn. They're in front of you on the road, but you got there first. You know, they're looking to see, and you just say, go ahead, you know, go ahead. They see it. Yeah, thanks. You know, like that. You got to communicate with your hands, with your eyes, with your attention. They see you, catch an eye. You see me. This you have to do this on the road. You know, but no, not these young people. The way they walk to school is crazy. Or ride their bikes, they're out of, they don't pay attention to the cars. They say, hey, we're entitled to ride our bikes and go to school safely, so we're safe. Or that's not the point. Safety is, it goes beyond safety. It has to do with the fabric of society. Now, some of them, you know, they're not everyone's this way, but there's a heavy, heavy contingent, enough to create an authoritative society, enough to fall under the spell of fascism, authoritativeness. Absolutely. These are the fascists. These are the ones who are eager to change the entire fabric of society into a fascist, totalitarian society. I'm always interacting, driving, you know, and so is everybody else, most people. It's like, hey, you know, you get to the intersection at the same time or something. Well, what's most convenient? What did I do today that helped somebody out a lot? A lot of stuff. You know, you're always making judgments and what's about safety and consideration, and, you know, you got to communicate. You cannot just be in your own world. And again, so many people are texting and not paying attention at stoplights, and then when you honk, 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 they raise their hand, but they still don't go because they got to finish the text. And then, okay, I'm almost done. Oh, okay, whoops, I missed the light turn red on me. Is this civil society, or is this tearing the fabric of society down, actually? At least if someone honks, stop reading the text and drive, you know? They don't even do that. It's really, seriously, they don't even do that. So, but this idea of, I don't have to pay attention to you. You know, you're circumscribed. I mean, you're circumscribed. What you can do is strictly defined. You're strictly defined in my world. And I know how you're defined, therefore I don't need to pay any attention to you. This is what it is. For as for me, I say, hey, I'm not defining you at all. I'm not defining your life at all. But pragmatically, you know, I gotta get across the road, and, you know, I'm sorry you gotta stop the stoplight. You know, who wants to stop? But so I'm not defining you that way, anything. So just letting you know, hey, you know, yeah. I just have the attitude that you know, thanks traffic for, you know, looking out for me. I'm looking out for you. We'll look out for one another. This is mental health. This is a healthy society. This is what we're losing. And this, we're plunging into an authoritative society. And it's the young people that are leading us there. And the voting bloc of young people is becoming very strong. Soon, you know, it will overpower the older people, the older generation, who has much, much better mental health, actually. And so we don't need an authoritative society. Let's we're free, you know. But now, so you have that aspect too, very severe aspect, and then we have the wild card, which is drugs. Cannot overemphasize this enough. This is what is surfacing now. I hadn't seen it till, you know, just this taping right here. First time I've seen this. I was under the assumption that we have seen all the drugs that there are to see, and people are going to get tired of them, and then that's it. Truly, I was under that assumption. Wow. What a false assumption. See, we're under these assumptions. We don't even realize that we're under them. This is why inquiry is so important. Very important. I met a guy at a store. This was a real blue-collar guy. He had friends in, I think, Seattle. And he knew the rough neighborhoods. I mean, so his friend also was aware of the street scene and all. And he told me there's an absolute heroin epidemic in Seattle and in the cities around the country. Huge, huge among the real lower class, you know, hard scrabble, you know, it hasn't hit the middle class yet, and it hasn't hit the upper blue collar class, really. It's the lower blue collar kind of, you know, class, lower class struggling for existence. It's hit them hard, real hard. And I heard somewhere else that there's a very severe heroin epidemic taking place. You just don't hear much about it because it's among the lower classes. But we say, oh well, okay, yeah, we've been through that kind of thing before, and it comes in waves, etc. But again, why would we assume we've seen the last of new drugs being introduced in the world? I mean, theoretically, it's possible that there's some super drug that has an effect on us that is just so addictive and that we just can't shake it. You know, that people would just go crazy for it. Theoretically, there could be such a drug. Because heroin has the problem that most people don't, you know, hygienically, it's just, you know, you got to be really, really hardcore to do heroin. And well, of course, there's oxycodone. I mean, the opiate painkiller epidemic was, that has been bad for quite some time. I don't know how bad it is now. Maybe it's worse than ever. So many, many people on painkillers. That's a silent epidemic. Hillbilly heroin. But again, we say, well, it's not that bad. So what I saw was something that was so bad that it is hard to even describe how severe it was. And I was shocked. I said, how is that possible? The severity, I said, how is that even possible? And so it has to be something cooked up that we have not come across yet. I can't possibly see the severity of that epidemic based on any of the drugs that the world has now. But just look at the, you know, the millennials. I mean, ecstasy was not around back in the 60s, 70s, 80s. I don't know when it came in, 90s sometime or something, maybe. I don't know. All the raver drugs, you know, DMT and all this kind of stuff. No, I mean, there was a time when that's a new drug, and everybody says, wow, like Huey Lewis says, I need a new drug, one that won't quit, one that won't make me feel 3 feet thick or something, won't make me feel 10 feet tall, or make me feel 3 feet thick. So you can bet that there are chemists all over the world working on it. Because I'll tell you this, drug trade is one of the biggest industries in the world. A lot of our history revolves around drug trade, especially more recently, Vietnam War, French Connection. I mean, the 60s drug epidemic, etc. They didn't want the war to end. and they didn't want all the war, you know, part of the, all the war protesters, such, and they wanted to try to pacify them. That is one theory. And they flooded young people with music and drugs that would kind of just make them want to, like, I just didn't really want to be too smartly activist and connect the dots. And now you have all these drug cartels in Mexico, Colombia, etc. And that we hear some whispers about that this is so profitable that, you know, they're allowed to continue on. So drugs are in huge business. Now imagine if there was a drug that everybody in the world really liked and was willing to take, not just, you know, the hardcore druggies, but just everyday normal people get up in the morning and say, hey, you know, I want to take this drug today because it makes me feel good. Well, of course, people are taking antidepressants, anti-anxieties, but this would be something that is like way more effective than all those. Now, you don't think, should we really think that the pharmaceutical companies aren't looking for such a drug? Do we really think that all the pharmaceutical companies in the world would do anything to come up with such a drug? And do we not think that those illegal drug traffickers are also trying to cook something up? Of course, they make more money if it's illegal. So it might be something that's legal. From the pharmaceutical companies, they'd want it legal. But there may be a strong black market in it in terms of, yeah. But just imagine, you know, if there was a global drug that was all around the world and was way, way, way more effective than the drugs we have now. And again, we can bet our lives on it that there's a massive effort to find that drug or a combination of drugs. Because there is just, you know, trillions of dollars in it, you'd have to say. It may be the next trillion-dollar industry, is this drug. Whatever drug, what do we want to call it? Maybe the trillion-dollar drug. Drug trillion dollars. The T drug. The trillion dollar drug. How do we know that this isn't actually right around the corner? I mean, there was a whole generation the 60s turned on, not only to pot, but especially psychedelics. I mean, it was the psychedelic era. That happened very fast. It happened in a matter of a couple years, actually. That's how fast it happened. Before then, there's only a few people, some intellectuals like Aldous Huxley, you know, Doors of Perception, who got a hold of this kind of stuff because it was being given out through intelligence agencies and high-level bureaucratic, you know, aristocratic, bureaucratic Illuminati circles. It was being distributed through them first. So, but the average person didn't even know about it at all. And then suddenly it hit the streets and flooded the streets. I don't know how Augustus Owsley, you know, I don't know how Owsley managed to get so much out onto the streets, you know, without being busted. This is the thing. Of course, it was legal for a while. But he, you know, lived a quote-unquote charmed life. Wonder why. A lot of the drug dealers lived charmed lives, actually. Freeway Rick Ross, I mean, the cocaine king of cocaine dealers in the United States, responsible for a lot of the cocaine in all the, you know, inner cities of the country, out of central LA, south central LA. How did he manage to do, you know, billion plus dollars of cocaine in that time? I mean, and get away with that? How is that possible? He lived a quote-unquote charmed life. So when the social engineers want the world to be flooded with drugs, it happens. It happens. when the British wanted China to be flooded with drugs, it happened. Because they were the authoritative society of that time. What they wanted to have happen, happened. So, when the social engineers want this world to be flooded with drugs, it's going to happen. And when that happens, it's severe effect. Like the psychedelic 60s, you couldn't escape it. I mean, if you're in that, I mean, it's everywhere. It affects your attitude, your mind, everything. Even if you're completely straight, sober, it still has a profound effect upon you. The whole culture, you know, the art, everything. The body language, the fashion. The hair, you know, the habits, all the art, the music, the entertainment, the discussion, the attitudes, everything is heavily, heavily, heavily changed by the drugs. I mean, you have a nice, I mean, you look at like someone like, who is a Ram Dass, for instance, Richard Alpert is a nice square Harvard man, you know. Or some of these other guys, you know, Timothy Leary, they're all square, straight, you know, straight arrow, military-industrial complex, you know, academia, sort of, you know, we're hip to, you know, the culture of the 50s. You look at them later, you know, it's just like complete transformation. This is the way it was. You get who? You know, just so many people... Oh, a perfect example, Jim Morrison, for instance, at the Doors, was very, very conservative. I mean, people thought he was just like some ultra-conservative, you know, military family. And of course, his family was military family. And then suddenly, within like a period of 6 to 9 months, he was this counterculture, leader of the counterculture. You know, just completely tripped out, and people said they couldn't even recognize him. This happened to a whole generation. An entire generation. I was talking to somebody how I used to look, and they couldn't believe it. They said, "I can't believe it. I cannot picture you that way." And I said, "Well, you know, this is what happens, and you go through different eras. When a world culture is flooded with drugs and people are under the influence, you know, people are changing. They change rapidly, and it's shocking, actually." Been through it. There's a psychedelic 60s, then the pot and it was very, and hashish and all that was very, that came in very strong, and then the cocaine came in, and that was a whole different vibe. And then ultimately the crack came, cocaine came in, and the crime, and things got, you know, scary in the culture. And then the methamphetamine, of course. Devastating methamphetamine here in California, especially the Central Valley. I don't even want to drive down the Central Valley. I mean, you go into a gas station there and you say, you know what? I don't particularly want to be here. I mean, it is weird. I mean, there's so many tweakers there, you just can't believe it. Hard to blame them. I mean, a lot of the agriculture is done at night. They have these huge farm machinery with massive Klieg lights on them. And they're going all night. It's 24/7, a lot of these farm operations. And the intensity of that big machinery is something else. So there's a lot of people that want to match the intensity of the situation. They use, you know, meth for that, but it's devastating. Devastating. So we have as a matter of fact, again, I've said this many times, that a great expert on ancient language said that what the Bible really says is the end times. You'll know you're in the end times when you're in this pharmaceutical culture, drug culture, pharmaceuticals. That's when you'll know you're actually in the end times. Well, we're here. And out of that culture, what is the symbol of that culture would be coming up with more potent drugs, more drugs that, you know, what the trademark of that, of such a culture. What can you expect from such a culture? Coming up with more drugs is what we would expect. We're constantly being bombarded with new drugs pharmaceutically to treat illnesses, but how about to treat attitude and mood? Because the social engineers most definitely have goals, okay? And they want, this is what social engineers do. Social engineers come from think tanks, which are supposed to identify the problems of the world and how to solve them. And they realize that they have to engage in social engineering in order to solve these problems. So they work on, well, how do we then social engineer society, culture? How do we do it? How do we do it fast? How do we do it effectively? You know, how much time do we have? How can we? And so they get together with, you know, the big wigs from these various can-do corporations and whatever. And they think tanks have liaisons between all these big can-do social engineering dynamics of the world, really. And so they say, hey, you know, this, you know, we need to conduct this sort of social engineering. So, you know, we need to all work together on this and be, you know, on the same page with it. And this is what happens. This is what actually happens in the world. You know, the marketers, you know, when it's all aligned, when you get the think tanks, the that includes the quote unquote, you know, the powerful secret societies, the Illuminati, the upper intelligentsia, the real power brokers, when all these people align, then the marketing aligns too. You know, they have the power. They're going to say, look, this is the culture we're going to create. This is the market we're creating for you. Start marketing to it. And so the smart marketers are tuned. They're part of all this, as is the media. The media is run by these big corporations because they're the ones that spend the advertising dollars. So they say, this is the culture that we want to create, to engineer. These are the products we want you to do. This is the marketing. This is how we want you to market it. And the commercials, the corporations make the commercials, but the content in entertainment becomes funneled into this. It's amazing at the power of social engineering that's at work in this world. It's astonishing. There's a whole level of society that are experts in this, and they feel they're entitled to do this. People have called them the Illuminati, you know, the Club of Rome, the Committee of 300 or whatever, 400, and on and on and on and on and on. They're these elites. They call them the elites. You know, the 1%ers, that they are very shrewd, and they want to make a lot of money, and they want things to run the way they want, you know, to help them make a lot of money and power and control. And they know social engineering. It's something they've been doing throughout history, this upper crust. It's completely natural to them, social engineering. It's part of their DNA. It's part of what they are. They don't even think twice of it. You know, people always bring up the name Rockefeller. Well, of course, yeah. I mean, Rockefeller is an example of that. They're hugely into social engineering, vastly into it. But that's just a name for example. We're not trying to pin anything on them, because it's way bigger than that. So if they see these think tanks say, hey, you know, this is what has to happen. The psychologists online, I mean, they have the psychiatric, psychological community, as, you know, that's Tavistock, for instance, in England. They have them in, you know, that's part of the whole thing. So it's a multifaceted approach to social engineering, very much multifaceted. United Nations is just one branch of this, just one branch, actually. Now, it's a big branch in terms of just sheer numbers and bureaucracy, etc. But it's not really, there are many other levels and branches that you might say are higher level than the United Nations. United Nations take their marching orders, you know. They're just the big kind of infantry. They're the infantry. They're not the generals. They're not the strategizers and all that, really, not really. But there is, you know, cross-fertilization taking place, and that, a lot of that for sure. Absolutely. And ultimately, you have the ETs also, extraterrestrials, which some people still don't believe. I know it's hard to believe that. I mean, really? You know, if you lived the last 70 years, you don't believe it, you don't realize that extraterrestrials exist. Okay, well, you're talking to somebody in a bubble then. They are very much, I mean, they're the ones who are giving ideas to the intelligentsia and upper crust of this world, because they claim that they have the answers. And who is to say that the ETs don't have the drugs too? Who is to say? And who is to say that it's the right time, that from their perspective, they're going to say, well, you know, we have something we want to share with you. And they'll whisper in the right ears, of course. Maybe telepathically, but no, there's a lot of hybrids, and there's some ETs in the world, actually. They'll get, there's ways, they have their ways. They're very clever. The upper crust is very clever. The ETs are even more clever in social engineering. They're even way more advanced. So they will simply say, hey, it's time, you know, it's time to introduce this drug or these drugs. It's time. Because if you don't do this, you're going to get too much backlash. Imagine if there was a drug that your opposition just couldn't resist, and it turned them into pliant, complacent, compliant. Oh yeah, go ahead, man, do whatever you want to do, man. It's all okay, you know, that kind of thing. Wouldn't those who want to win, wouldn't they want that drug? They would want it, wouldn't they? And if the ETs want some side to win, want some, you know, agenda to win, don't you think the ETs will say, hey, you know, we have these drugs. Let's use them now. We talk about chemical warfare. We say, you know, this, nobody can do this. It's terrible. We've agreed that this has not happened. But is not flooding the globe with drugs, is that not some sort of chemical warfare, actually? Of course it is. You say, well, it doesn't kill the enemy. Yeah, but it makes them defeated. It defeats them. And what is the enemy, what is the opponent fighting for? Some ideology, right? So ultimately, it's the same result. Ideology is defeated, goes down to defeat. So drugs are really chemical warfare. Look at it that way. It's a new way of looking at it, isn't it? Pretty amazing. So you got a combination of, I say, called cosmic corporate culture. And it truly is, there is a cosmic corporate culture. Bet on it. Bet your life on it. This is a truth. There is not only is there a corporate culture on this planet, there's a cosmic corporate culture. And the two of them are in bed together, actually. And they, you know, they recognize, I mean, it's certainly there are recognizable parameters of this planet. We can measure that, can show us there's a lot of change taking place. You know, sensitive, there's certain sensitive barometers. And there is a massive environmental change taking place. There's no doubt about it. And apparently the ETs, they say, we know how this goes. We know if things happen beyond a certain threshold, you know, planet goes into free fall. Well, that's what they say. And, you know, whether this is a truism or not, we don't know for sure. But you can be sure that they have steps that they can take. And I would say the one, number one, would be some new class of drugs in the world. Don't you think that psychiatrists would jump on that? I mean, they got everybody doped up on maximum levels of antidepressants and anxieties. I mean, they got everybody, not everyone. I want to just drive home the point, so I use this, you know, language like everybody. But the viewer understands, full stop, and the wow viewers understand. We're getting to the wow here. That's what's important. And you don't think they would all jump at something like this, say, hey, you know, we can get you off all these other drugs, because this one will take care of, you know, will take care of, help you out more than any other. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, there's some mental health people, and There always have been that have prescribed these new drugs to people. They were prescribing hallucinogens, psychedelics to their patients when it was legal. Absolutely. In fact, a lot of the psychedelics came out from psychiatrists to their patients, and then their patients began getting some from illicit sources and passing around to their friends. This is a lot of how it happened. There's a lot of the upper class who were in therapy with psychoanalysts and psychiatrists who got these various drugs from, you know, the psychiatrist said, let's try this out. This seems to be as promising. That's how it happened. A lot of it came through the intelligentsia and the upper classes, and it worked its way down. Now, what if this drug is some sort of electromagnetic device that you wear, like on your head? Or what if it's some sort of electromagnetic device that you have implanted? What if it's some sustained release drug that you have, you know, a patch or something? So, or what if it's some sort of electromagnetic radiation that you have towers put up so that everybody in the whole area is affected by this? Some kind of wave technology, electromagnetic wave technology, affects your brain waves. Or what is a combination of all these and more? What if it's something they put in our water? Becomes mandatory. You can't find any water without it. All water out of the tap, all bottled water has it. Everything in the store has it. What if it's something like that? So how do you drink unless you have a well? And they make wells illegal. They'd have their spy satellites looking this with some sort of, you know, filters looking for water and, you know, wells and shutting them down. So you can't have any of that stuff. Can't have any good water anymore. It's very interesting. Quite a few people have said to me, independently said, that they feel that the water is going to be the biggest problem in the future. Drinking water. I said, how is that really possible, actually? Maybe they're meaning that pure water is going to be the trouble. Getting pure water is going to be the trouble. Untreated water. They already put fluoride in most people's water, right? We just got it here in our place recently. Just in this last year. I don't drink tap water. I only drink distilled water. I've been drinking distilled water for maybe 30 years or more. So we're looking at this together, aren't we? The premise that we're looking at is based on this very prophetic dream that I feel very strongly, so strongly, that this is what's going to happen. This is what's coming, and interpreting it as an actual time of severe drug epidemic. Beyond anything, it's so much greater than the ones previous that it's hard to even explain how it could happen. So we're looking at how is it possible, and it may not just be a pill, right? It may not just be some kind of drug. It may be something much more sinister than that. Maybe they're going to broadcast something through smartphones that affect the brain waves. So if you have anything on your body, a smartphone, they somehow are able to control it to put out radio signals, radio frequencies, or some sort of frequency, maybe a microwave frequency, I don't know. How they would do, but something like that, that affects people. Maybe they're already doing it. And you know, the kids, the young people would say, oh yeah, we love it. Maybe if they knew about it, they'd say, well, great. Let's do as much as possible here. We need to transform society. So they're willing social engineers. Now keep in mind that many in the 60s, 70s, whatever, they were very willing to go along with the social engineering. Absolutely. Because they said, yeah, we have to transform ourselves. This military-industrial complex thing is leading us to disaster. So they were absolutely willing to be transformed. They took as many drugs as possible, trying to change their minds. Of course, many of them died. Many of them burned out. Wasn't a pretty picture. Some did social engineer themselves to such a strong extent that they gave birth to the millennials. And now the millennials have done it to such a strong extent they've given birth to what? What was this generation? Generation drug? Generation D for drugs. They seem to view being drugged as their birthright, that they're entitled to it. Totally different attitude. They're entitled to it. And anyone who stands in their way is terrible, terrible, evil person. So, you put all this combination of factors together, all right? You can do it different ways. If you're a mathematician, you can look at it that way, so to speak. I'm not a mathematician. Maybe I am a spiritual mathematician, actually. I don't know. I mean, but as far as actual math, I just do, you know, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. That's it. I don't think math, but this, you know, spiritual equations, you know, this is a spiritual equation. And so, you know, if in some are mathematical, do the math. See what you come up with. So this is all dawning, you know, this is dawning and seeing what really happened in the last 70 years, the social engineering, the alphabet agencies that were involved in it, but more than that, way more than that, it went way further than that. I was talking with someone today about Area 51, you know, they say they've bought up all the surrounding land now, so you can't even get close to it. Before, there was this bluff, mountain range bluff, you could go on with high-powered binoculars and lenses and take photographs and take a look at what's going on there. They bought that up now. So you can't even get close to it. And people say, oh, yeah, sure, nothing's going on there. What are they talking? No, you know. Well, whatever has leaked out of there certainly indicates that there's a lot going on there. As there are in other areas, Nevada, you know, California, desert. How do we know what's in the pipeline except through spiritual intuition and dreams, etc., right? So it's very important to pay attention to certain dreams. Certain dreams are such attention getters, you realize this is prophetic. Pay attention to them, which I do. Because this is how we, you know, pre-plan to social engineer ourselves out of their clutches. Sidestep, the social engineer is sidestepping of what they're social engineering. So we're not caught unawares by it. And of course, wise parents help their children do that. I mean, wise parents may realize that, hey, there's some drugs coming up, and they become aware of it before the kids do, maybe. And they say, well, we got to get our kids into something really positive for them so they don't go into this. And then get them in Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, sports, try to get them really involved so they don't fall prey to the drugs. But when really big drug epidemics come, that doesn't work for a lot of people. Even that pressure's too much. Pressure's too much. And of course, women on drugs are just terrible. Absolutely terrible. Worst thing in the world, women on drugs. Social contract just comes, crashing down. So, and that's another thing that's changed so much. It used to be that women did not use drugs. They didn't drink very much. I mean, they tried to keep themselves healthy because they're having children. I mean, their lives, we're going to have, a lot of children. So they think, got to be real. I can't just, be a drug addict. No way. And the ones that were looked down upon very severely as terrible, terrible role models. They were not allowed to be role models. Now, it's changed so drastically. Where, nobody thinks twice about women using drugs. Oh, it's like, great, Well, that's awesome. Maybe your child will be a star child or something, using acid or something. Wow, that's great. You're opening your consciousness. So, this is a massive change that has happened. And it's not a good equation at all, actually. Women on drugs is not a good equation. Anybody on drugs, but specifically women on drugs, they tend to pull a lot of people down into drugs because the overall social equation is that way. Where that's how it works. It seems like another thing, they want to get women on drugs. There's no question about it. Because they're the ones that should be the most resistant to it. But once women go on drugs, the men just follow suit. The women say, hey, man, they're so loose, they seduce the man, and they say, wait a minute, but you got to take these drugs. I got to make sure that you're one of us. You're a real, true friend. And then the men just cave in. This is how it happened. This is how it happens, actually. No question about it. That the women always have this, who are on drugs or some activists on drugs, they always have a test. They give the man, say, well, first I got to know, if you're one of us, if you're with us or not. If you're not, sorry, I lost my interest in you. And so, but they engineer it in such where the man is in such a, so badly seduced that he's like, Herod, Philip, Salome, he says, I'll give you anything you want. She says, give me the head of John the Baptist. He's so, he's into, over his head with seduction. So they do it that way. They don't do it up front. They wait until they have the man in a vulnerable situation. And then they say, oh, yeah, we have this little acid test, but we know you're one of us anyway. We just got to, be sure. And then the man says, wow, I got tricked, I got trapped. This is how it happens. And you get these women, activist drug women, who seduce hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of men, actually. Absolutely, this is how it happens. They're these druggies, and they're super promiscuous. And they insist that these men get into drugs too. Absolutely. This is literally how it's happened before. And this is the blueprint. This is the blueprint. And then you get these power couples, power drug couples. Well, real, real beautiful, seductive woman has some alpha male, and they go around and she says, hey, you can be part of our, court, the king, the queen in our court. Yeah, combination of women and drugs is really, really terrible. Interesting. And a lot of men, they don't really want to. I mean, they gotta work. You know, they gotta do stuff. They got to be responsible. I mean, come on. They get in over their heads. Some of them wake up later, years later, say, "What happened?" Some of them don't wake up. Some of them go to sleep permanently. It's a rough thing. It's bare knuckle. This is social engineering. I mean, this is bare knuckle stuff here. This is hardball. And my feeling is that the worst hardball the world's ever seen is coming now. Very soon. Again, the speed of drug distribution can be astonishing, actually. Anyone who lived through the 60s will tell you that. Anyone who lived through the 80s, the cocaine epidemic, will tell you that. That it happens fast. It can happen in a year, year and a half, 2 years. Everything's flipped. Everyone's flipped out. Everyone's changed, 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 changed. So change can happen very, very fast now. Now, what I was getting at is something very, very interesting that I've noticed. I was in the store today waiting for something, sitting down waiting. They had the television on, waiting room, okay. And this is some talk show, blah, 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 blah. I tuned it out, you know, but as I was paying my bill, you know, I heard it, you know, so it's right there blasting, and it's like, what are they talking to? Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it was just all these women on this talk show, and what are they talking about? Molestation, how they're all molested when they were young. But, well, we've heard this, you know, for years and years and years and years, just like things tends to be the most important topic on all these women's talk shows. But what I heard was a totally weird thing. I said, these are not people that really been truly molested. I mean, they're talking about, the way they're talking about it is a strategy. Clearly, I wasn't looking, I was just hearing the audio. You know, I'm not looking at them. I said, this is not therapy that really went through. They're talking about some sort of uber strategy. Like, and it's like, interesting. There's something very, very odd with this whole molestation movement, where I think they're creating false memories in a lot of them. They're fudging the whole situation. But, I got the feeling that they're kind of, the way they were talking about it is saying, hey, we've all been molested. This is what they sort of were bringing up, is to say, well, you know, all women get molested. And then they're trying to create this victim consciousness out of this, okay? A sort of collective victim consciousness that women have. This is what they're aiming for. This is very clear, another Gestalt moment, many Gestalt moments today. Thank you, Jesus. 50th anniversary of A Course in Miracles. Clarity, clarity, clarity. And I'm saying, wait a minute. Could this be the emotional trauma that women are claiming, that we were all molested? Could this be this psychological trauma that this miracle drug is actually going to come out and target, and say, and the women will just jump on it and say, this drug will relieve the memory and the trauma of your molestation and empower you so that you're over it. You see what I'm saying? And when the women get into this drug, then it's easy to get the men using this drug too. So I think the women have been building up this false memory syndrome of we're all been victimized. This is what they were saying on the show, is like, yeah, I don't remember. I think someone said, well, I'm not really remember, but sure, but I'm sure I was, you know. I mean, aren't we all? You know, they're just probably blocking it. And the casual way that they were talking about it, to me, it said, this is something completely different than truly talking about true molestation. This is something completely different. So, if you add it up, this has been going on for a long time. This victim, they seem to, it's like they feel they have to get this victim complex. This is what makes them, going to make them great. This is going to, you know, this started with Oprah and some of these talk show people always talking about molestation. Oh yeah, I was molested horribly. But this, But this is like a badge of greatness, a badge of honor. This, you know, somehow this gives me, I'm entitled, gives me some great entitlement, some sort of victim entitlement consciousness that's been heavily seeded through the females on this planet. So much so that they were so casually talking about it in a way I said, this is a red flag, if ever I've heard a red flag. They're talking about a syndrome that they feel they all have the same syndrome. And that the syndrome then brings up the problem solution. What happens when you have a solution, you create a that makes you a ton of money and social engineers, you create a problem for it. So I would say that we've been social engineered, especially the women, into believe they have this molestation syndrome, a general victimization syndrome. That, and then someone who's already had this drug, that, you know, from some high level of could be the ETs, or high level of the intelligentsia of this planet, then they can introduce this drug to women and saying, this actually is a cure. It's the only way to cure this syndrome. It's the only way to really cure it. And you could bet your bottom dollar that it would spread like wildfire throughout this world. Because the women feel this entitlement that they're taking drugs, if they feel they're entitled to it. They're huge drug users as far as pharmaceuticals go. Huge. Just pill poppers. So if they get this drug and say, this is going to cure your molestation syndrome that you share with all your sisters, you know, all you have it, you all have it. Even if it didn't happen to you, you still have it. It's affecting your happiness. This is why you're not happy. Not because your spirit pretending that you're not spirit. Not because you have a severe continuity fear, which is the real truth. But because you have this molestation syndrome. Then they can market this drug. And it will spread throughout the planet, you know, in a year's time. Like wildfire. It'll spread faster than Viagra. 10 times faster. And that'll pull everybody into it. And good luck anybody saying they can't take it. Are you kidding? They feel so entitled at this point. So entitled from their victimization to use this new drug that, you know, they won't listen to anyone. Wow. Thoughts, hey, it's still the 21st. Hey, how about a thank you, Jesus, for this, you know? I said, I was assuming that you know, nothing is going to happen on the 21st. It's pretty amazing, but this is astonishing. This is fantastic information that has come through here. Just, you know, detective work. We're doing detective work here. And all these gestalts that I had today and the experience I had today putting it together, say, oh my gosh. This could be this mother of all drug epidemics in the world, which will be the mother of all social engineering in the world, which will put everybody in this stoned out haze, which will make them go along with the young authoritarians, generation young authoritarian, we might call it, generation young authoritarian. The young A's, Generation Young A, or Generation A, we could call it Generation A for authoritarian. Yeah, let's call it Generation A. So the Generation A'ers. A'ers, there's a name to connect up with social engineering. You know, the president's buddy, Mr. A'ers. Anyway, Generation A, the Generation A'ers. Yeah, that's just what they want. That's absolutely what they want. And the those that would have stood in their way are now out of their way. Because generally women want men to be industrious, because women want nice homes, nice everything, actually. What don't they want nice? And what don't they want better? They always want something better. So they drive the industriousness of men, no question about it. Men realize to please the women, they got to be very industrious. Yeah, it's keep up with the Joneses. You know, hey, my friend down the street has this car. You know, I don't feel like really loved because my car is kind of old. And is that how you view me? You know, as I'm getting old, huh? This is how it is. I said, you must think I'm getting old because I have an old car. I mean, so you must not love me very much because I must not be attractive to you. I'm getting old, you know. Wow. Just feels like this is just, I don't really feel much anymore, you know, in this relationship. And then what do you do? The man says, oh, wow. Yeah, I don't want you. No, you're not old. You're not old. Well, really, I feel old when I drive the car. No. Okay, don't worry. I'll get you a new car. So she gets a brand new car. And then she goes to her friend, look at me. I got a new car. How awesome is that? So there's always this feminine competition going on for newer and better. And this drives the men. So if the women are drugged out, the men are just going to also just, you know, they'll get drugged out too. They just will sit around in a coffee shop. And the industriousness of the world will drop severely. Now, I'm just simply bringing this to light is all. There's a better way to reach low levels of industrious, which is spiritual practice. But I don't think that people do that. So the problem is in this kind of drugged out world, right spiritual practice is probably going to go the way of the dodo bird. Because I said that the drugged out society, it affects everybody severely in every way possible. Like pouring pollution into a lake. The lake's so polluted, you know, it kills all the fish. It doesn't matter where the fish are living. It spreads out everywhere. So it may be a very adverse situation for those on the spiritual path. Very adverse. Which is maybe why Jesus is warning us about this and the Holy Spirit warning us about this ahead of time. In fact, I would bet on it. So Jesus did give us a big gift here on the 50th anniversary of A Course in Miracles here. This is a big gift to see this. This is putting two and two and two and connecting them together and connecting the dots in a most extraordinary way. Get up tomorrow somewhat early. Well, this has been a big benefit here. Big boost, to say the least. Kind of shocking, right? Kind of wow, it's very shocking. But all the experience of my life has been put together to be able to see this. The hindsight, the perspective, living through all this. And indeed, it does work the way that I'm seeing it now. That's exactly how it's worked. I mean, I've been doing investigative reporting my whole life on social engineering. Really, I've been observing it and investigating it. It's a nasty game. I mean, it's a tough game. And drugs are its name, you know? Drugs are the name of the game, actually. And it's very insidious. Drugs are very insidious, actually. You lose sight, when you're on drugs, you lose sight of the social engineering that's happening to you. You're not aware of it. That's why, again, spiritual path is always admonishing, no drugs, can't use drugs. You cannot use drugs. I mean, even, you know, caffeine, alcohol, cigarettes, those are all drugs. You know, can't use those either. You're going to, you know, there, as I said, there's no more dangerous drug pusher than a woman, a beautiful woman, or women in general. Devastating drug pushers. Oftentimes, the way it works is like, for instance, someone's heroin dealer or something, is a lot of the pimps and prostitutes, the pimps are drug dealers. Okay, let's be honest about this, clear about this, is the man is the one risking, you know, life by getting the drugs and then running the drugs, you know. But he needs customers. So he hooks up with this beautiful loose woman, and she gets him the customers. What she does, she turns on the men through sex, and then and promising sex, and then the man has to use drugs beforehand. And then she may get, you know, called away or at the last moment or whatever, but the man's already on drugs. I mean, they have many, many tricks they use. And then they get the men on drugs, and then so the man then goes to her connection, her boyfriend, and he gets the connection, all right? So he makes all the money, and then the money comes back to her for designer clothes, beautiful cars, beautiful homes, all this stuff. It's exactly how it works. So who's using who? Well, the woman is the user, in this case, to the ultimate extent. I mean, and of course the man benefits too from it. They both benefit from it. And oftentimes the woman doesn't even use the drugs. Sometimes the man doesn't either, actually. But sometimes they both do, actually. They do. And of course, a woman on drugs is a lot looser and willing to make help, you know, hook these guys, hook, you know, into the drugs. And actually, they also hook women and say, hey, look, you can do this too. You, like, look at all these great designer clothes I'm always wearing, you know. I mean, why don't you turn on to these drugs? And once they turn the women onto the drugs, then they say, hey, why don't you turn your boyfriend onto them, you know, because he'll buy you the stuff. If you give him drugs, he'll buy you more stuff. And so this whole, you know, drug culture, drug side is nasty, nasty stuff. It's so nasty, you know, that we're all under the influence of it, actually. This is what I'm seeing right now. I've never been able to break free of it. The drug culture is so terrible that we feel, you know, somehow entrapped by it. It's woven itself into the fabric of our culture, actually. As I say, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, that is the formula they use. And it's all social engineering behind it, actually. And they're definitely after the women. The women think that they're being helped. No. You know, they're being social engineered to a hideous extent. False memory syndrome, false molestation syndrome. They're going to likely give them drugs for that. They'll be drugged, and then they'll get their men hooked on drugs. It's all designed to lower the industriousness of the planet, of the people on the planet. Lower expectations in every way possible. Lower expectations, but you know, in a way that has devastating consequences, side effects, unintended consequences. It's not the real spiritual path at all. It makes a mockery of it. Holy cow! This is really, really something. Seeing all this and being able to verify it from a historical perspective, having lived through all this. So all sorts of clever drug pushers where you go to parties, there's going to be some, guaranteed. All sorts of people are making money, you know, making money on drugs. And this continues and continues, and probably more so than ever. You always wonder, you know, where do these women get all these super expensive clothes? You know, if you really look into it and check it, you realize they must have a fortune. They don't have a job. What's a boyfriend? What are they? I mean, where do they get the money? Is it, where is he making all that money? Oh, he just got a flashy new car. Like, you know, wow. They don't say where they get the money. You know, it's, oh, shh, the secret, man. We don't want to talk. Okay. Now, nowadays, women have a lot more opportunities for jobs and making money. But again, I feel the women are going to be targeted. It's always that way. Once the woman goes, the man will go along. Always. It's that way, or hit the highway and lose all, everything. And they'll, since the false memory syndrome, they'll accuse the man of all this stuff that he never did in the relationship and blackmail him. This is another huge trouble that's going on, that this is the laws, the protection that men have from false memory syndrome and blackmail have been completely wiped out, totally wiped out. There's another thing that I feel the Holy Spirit's showed me very clearly. Men have no safety need. Here's what happened today. Wow. It's an incredible, miraculous day, actually. I'm at a gas station, and there's this lady talking on a cell phone real loud, and really, she's very distraught. And she says, the bus wouldn't let me on. I'm stranded. Basically, it's a femme fatale, stranded. There's this lady, stranded. She says, I can't get there. I have to walk there. Well, she's got to walk, like, be in the middle of the night till she gets there. It's, like, terrible. She said, I don't guess she didn't have any money or something. I don't know what happened, but she's stranded. So I'm hearing this. And I'm saying, wow, that's terrible. This elder lady. And so I'm thinking, well, you know, be a good Samaritan. I'll just give her a ride where to her friend's house. She's talking to her friend or whatever. I don't know why they can't come pick her up, you know. But I just thought, well, give her a ride. What the heck? I was off work and said, it'll take, 10 minutes or something for in the car. It's no big deal. Then I thought, someone said, well, yeah, I don't know. Should I really do that or that? I mean, back in the 50s, 60s, stuff. Of course you give someone a ride. It's not a big deal at all. No, you think twice about it. However, there was that what came about eventually in culture was. Women felt it was too dangerous to take a ride with men. It was too dangerous. So they're all men are rapists, you know. They can't get in a car with a man, stranger, a man you don't know. Is so that became taboo. So women would not take a ride with a man. Well, I didn't think of that at the time. It never crossed my mind, you know. It's just, if someone's stranded needs help, you give them help. But then this woman in a car suddenly drove up, and she said, hey, ma'am. And she said, she gave them some money, a couple dollars, I think, for the bus or something. She says, here, and then she gave her instructions. So she helped her out, gave her a couple dollars. She didn't give her a ride, which would have certainly solved it, because the lady then kept talking about, she still had a lot of problems of walking, you know, very troubled person with, you know, really, they were really having a difficult time. But she said, okay, someone blessed, she said, oh, I've just been blessed, someone just blessed me with some money, maybe let me on the bus with this money. So then I said, okay, I said, I still could have given her a ride. I said, no, she's got the money for the bus, let her work it out. And then I drove off, and then suddenly it hit me, the Holy Spirit said, hey, you know what, she said, remember how it became in culture that a woman would never accept a ride from a man because it was too dangerous for them, and so we never even asked, you wouldn't do it. The Holy Spirit, guess what? Now it's completely flipped and said it's not safe for a man to give a ride to a woman. It's not safe for a man to give a ride to a woman. I suddenly realized that, wow, you're right. You're absolutely right. I said, I wouldn't do it. I absolutely wouldn't do it. It's not safe. You have no legal protection. This whole false memory syndrome thing has been so pounded into women, and the idea that they can shake a man down. Any woman could shake a man down now. He said, she said, she always wins, period. And it's too dangerous for men to give women rides anymore, under any circumstance. And I said, wow, how things have completely flipped. No legal safety net for this anymore. So, here is another facet to the situation. Women can get with a man and say, hey, I want you to take this drug. The man says, no. You know, I've heard some that this really puts you under mind control. I'm kind of scared. She goes, well, you know, maybe, you know, they go home together from a bar or something. And she says, well, guess what? you know, if you don't take this drug, I'm going to call 911 and say that you attacked me, molested me, assaulted me, etc., etc., etc. And she says, my word against yours, she'll grab the guy's hand and scratch her face with the guy's fingernails or something, and then say, look, DNA, your DNA, my DNA's on your fingernails or stuff. They're very clever about this. And she says, I'll just say that you assaulted me. Or you can take the drug and I'll have a great time with me, you know? Pretty easy choice, isn't it? The guy has no recourse. Has no recourse. Except to pray to the Holy Spirit. Which I highly suggest everybody starts doing pronto. And yeah, the guys may be saying, "Wow, the good times just ended for me." Yeah, absolutely, they did. But the perfect times are coming for you. So, who cares if the good times end? If the perfect times are coming, you know what? To feel perfect, nothing has to happen whatsoever. In order to feel perfect, nothing has to happen at all. In order to feel imperfect, something has to happen. Something has to happen. So to feel perfect, nothing has to happen. To feel imperfect, something has to happen. And it has to keep happening. Somethingness has to happen. Thingness, which means time, space, process, and form. Somethingness has to happen, which means a dream. Which means a fantasy. But to be perfect, no thingness has to happen. There can't be any thingness happening at all. So nothing has to happen. In order to feel perfect. To feel perfect, when you recognize nothing is happening, you will feel perfect. When you're seeing things happening, you won't feel perfect. So, it should be dawning on everybody, the good times are over. Especially the men. The women might feel, might still be thinking like, hey, maybe, I can get a lot out of this. But for the men, they realize that they're cooked. Their goose is cooked, it's absolutely cooked. You will have to take the drugs. I mean, any woman can put you in a situation where you have to take it. Or, you're cooked. You're cooked either way. However, there's the option of the Holy Spirit. The option that Jesus has for us. Which is perfection. Nothing has to happen to feel perfect. Because in reality, there's no thingness happening at all. That is perfection. Perfection means there's no exception. Flawless. It's flawless. There's no thing that's happening. That's flawlessly so. So this is, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. This has just been a tremendous opportunity to share very high level information here coming from the Holy Spirit and the detective work that the Holy Spirit has helped out with. Yeah, and that talk show, I realized they're all rehearsing false memory syndrome. That's what they were doing. They're rehearsing it, so they'll all back each other up. They're at a party, get a guy in a room, and oh yeah, he tried to rape me, if they didn't take the drug. And the West Roman will say, yeah, I saw it, yeah. Yeah, I was a witness to it. False memory syndrome, to bearing false witness. They're practicing bearing false witness. That's what they're doing. Thou shalt not bear false witness, but we're in a false witnessing society. And it's coming on those talk shows that women are paying so much attention to. And have been for quite some time. Now, I was a red flag. I was very suspicious. I said, something here is really, really rotten in Denmark here. No offense to Denmark by saying that. It's just a common idiomatic expression. But There's something really, there's a rat. I smell a rat. Something really stinks here. But I couldn't figure out what it is. I mean, it's so terrible that I couldn't wrap my mind around it. I know it's something really bad, but you can hardly, you don't want to believe it. You don't want to believe your goose is cooked as far as women go, you know. You don't want to feel like, wow, the good times are over. I mean, there's no chance of any good times anymore. Forget it. That's a very difficult conclusion for any man to come to. And of course, you know, this can be played out, this game, this blackmail game can be played out in every direction. In the gay community, it can play out the same thing, you know. The gays can use it on other gays, saying, hey, you know, this guy didn't play along, didn't take the drug, and he was like, suddenly became totally homophobic and started using slurs on me or something, and they can accuse somebody, you know, of that, even though they're, you know, both gay or something. Absolutely, same with lesbians, same thing. So this is a nasty game. There's no escape from it. You can't just go gay and escape it. Not possible. A lot of people actually go gay. They're not born that way at all. This is a myth that all gays are born that way. Not even close to the truth. A lot of people go that way. They think it's safer bet, you know. They see the goose is cooked in one direction, they go in that direction. Well, I'm telling you, everybody's goose is cooked in this world. Everybody's goose is cooked. Except those who listen to the Holy Spirit and are willing to accept perfection, which means that there's nothing we need to do. It's inherent. It's an inherent fact. There's no such thing. There's no thingness. There's no circumstances or situations. There's nothing that we need to do in order to be what we are, in order to be perfect and flawless and free and experiencing a flow of experience. Not a flow of thingness, but a flow of experiencing. Wow, this video is going very slow. This is very astonishing to me. How is this possible? I don't know. It's like time has slowed down severely. I mean, I can't believe this. I just looked at it, it was like 2:04, now it's 2:06. I think it's like so much time has passed. How's this possible? The intensity here is so extreme, it feels like time has slowed down. So much is being said here. It seems like it must have taken a long time to say it, but it matters, I said it in a couple minutes. Interesting. Is it? Oh, it's almost midnight here. Well, Jesus gave us his miracle today. Jesus did give us a great 50th anniversary miracle. But I wonder how many ACMI or ACIMers, A Course in Miracles, I wonder how many of them are open to this kind of information at all. Now they're busy trying to turn into ravers, you know. Yeah, that's just right. The drug thing's coming too. We're gonna be even better ACIMers, you know. Just use drugs and we'll just really feel it. Yeah, let's have an ACIM rave, you know. Interesting. Nice way to co-opt it, isn't it? Holy Spirit always told me, don't pay attention to all this, these so-called leaders of ACIM, and just don't pay any attention. Just go faster. Don't just, you know, you'll see later on why. Not everybody that is a big, you know, mover and shaker in A Course in Miracles, not everyone is necessarily all that, actually. Some of them could actually be co-opting it, you know, into dualistic perspective. and playing along with the social engineering, actually. Same old, same old, right? More, absolutely. What's new? You know, big surprise, no. In these advertisements, you know, what are you going to do to empower her, girls, what are you going to do to empower girls? You know, this is how they're now spinning things. Like it's some kind of duty, like, you know, what are you going to do? Well, this leads right into the whole agenda. I'm saying, oh, the women will say, oh, this is what you can do to empower me. This will really help empower me. And this will help get rid of the guilt for all the molestation that you put upon us, you know. So they'll use that too. That this will free you from the guilt that you must have. You have, I know you have it because I'm telling you have it. And this will empower me, you know, for you to do this, to admit that your guilt will be greatly liberating and empowering for you. So take this drug, you have to take it. Just look at the social pressure that has been structured now into the situation by these, you gotta say, genius engineers, very devious, but social engineers, very devious, but genius to this is very powerfully effective, what they've come up with. And I know the men realize they're cooked. I mean, every man I come across is, If he one way or another, he expresses like, says, we don't have a chance. We're absolutely cooked. He says, I don't know what to do about it. I have no clue. This is what you get. You read the book. You read the signs. Read the tells that they make. You know, in poker, there's what's called tells, and what tells is if you're really sharp, you can tell what kind of hand someone else is holding. You know, there are ways to do it. You know, you might say something, or you might, you know, there's all sorts of ways to get reactions, to get tells. You know, the really great poker players, they know what you're holding because they read the tells. Same thing with great hitters in baseball. They read the pitcher. They can read the pitcher. They pretty much know what the pitcher's going to throw. Barry Bonds was the best at that. Yeah, he could tell. And Willie Mays was great too, and he taught Barry Bonds. Willie Mays was fantastically brilliant at that. So like the great poker card players, they can tell. Well, you can tell in society. You can read the tells if you're really sharp, and you can tell what's really on their mind, what the real attitude is. And I can tell the men are freaked out, and they realize we're cooked. It's either, you know, drugs or jail, or more than jail, ruination. It's drugs or ruination. And they're looking at their future just like, you know, do I have a future, really? And they're preoccupied, and they're just, you know, there's this mood among the young men especially. It's just like, what did I get myself into here? This is just terrible. And of course, the women are into it. Say, hey, we're going to save the world. We're going to save the world. We're going to completely social engineer the world and save the world. We're going to be the saviors of the world. So they have a very different attitude. They're saying, we know we got a little secret. They always have a secret, a little secret. And because they're very adept social engineers, they've always been social engineers. Women have been social engineering men from the very beginning. But right now, they got a little secret. So they're feeling pretty, you know, frisky right now. They say, we know that something's going to help us out, and we're going to social engineer and completely change the world and save Mother Earth from destruction, and we're going to be the heroines of the new age. So they're feeling pretty good about themselves right now, whereas the men are not. they're saying we're going to be crushed. I always say women's liberation is to give up the desire to crush men. You know, that's the best definition of women's liberation. If a woman wants to be liberated, give up the desire to crush men. That's, you know, that inquiry. Where does that desire come from? That should be the inquiry. You want to be liberated? Where does the desire to crush men come from? This is the question. Men, you know, social engineering often is crushing. So it comes from social engineering. Where does that come from? You know, and so start inquiring and doing that. Where does that come from? Now, some women don't want to crush men. Those are the ones on the spiritual path. You can tell the difference. You can tell the difference. A man can tell the difference. She's not interested in crushing you. And the man just then relaxes. You know, it's like, wow, isn't that rare? You know, she's not interested. Not interested in social engineering, really. Not interested. That doesn't work. Been there, done that. Doesn't work. I want liberation. You know, big difference. Big difference. A world full of women like that, and everyone would be enlightened pretty quickly. But they're actually very rare, unfortunately. And then, you know, they're not interested in relationships or anything like that, in special relationships. No, they just say, I'm not interested anymore in social engineering, crushing men. I know that that's just a road of misery for me. Been there, done that. And so I'm just doing inquiry. Why? Where does that come from? Where does that come from? Detective work. Hey, midnight, bing, bingo, look at that. Jesus, thank you for all the information you've given us here. It's quite extraordinary. And corollary to that, a woman's liberation is to give the desire to crush men. A woman's place is abidance and no place. Okay, where is a woman's place? A woman's place is abidance and no place. Which means in immersion. Woman's place is in immersion, actually. Immersion in what? Immersion in immersion. It's man's, as a man's place, too. That's everyone's place. But, you know, it's a play on a woman's place is in the home, or a woman's place is to be president, or a woman's place is to be in CEO, a woman's place is to dominate men, a woman's place. No, a woman's place is to be immersed in no place. So we'll see what the Holy Spirit, Jesus, will empower us with in terms of this, you know, disempowerment situation in the world. You know, we're the good times are, you know, over. We're cooked. You know, this, what, between a rock and a hard place, what kind of remedy does Jesus have for this? So, you know, it's great that we've seen this, because now, you know, the remedy can fit the problem. You know, if Jesus recommends a remedy, it's definitely going to fit the problem that Jesus is aware of. And as we become more aware of the severity of the problem, then it's easier for Jesus to tell us what the remedy is, because he'll say, oh, yeah, well, I can see I really need that. That's necessary. Wow. As long as we think that the good times are still possible, you know, we won't look, we won't listen. Good times are gone. They never were good, but at least we could imagine they were. We could trust one another, you know. We're not all drug pushers trying to social engineer one another. Yeah, the good times are gone. But this is coming fast, fast, fast. Who knows? I mean, it could be the very next day. They could say, hey, guess what? You know, we've been working on this pill to help, you know, women with these traumas. And it also works on male guilt, too. How about that? Or maybe there's a his and hers, you know, molestation memory trauma and male guilt trauma. You know, different pills for different things, right? And yeah. Social engineering, as I say, is a nasty game, and the folks that run it, they're very shrewd, and they're really shameless, yeah, because from their standpoint, they're guardians of the world, and the ends justify the means entirely. So they're just used to thinking that way. It's just the way it is. So they'll say, okay. You know, how about this? Let's try this. But they're heedless of spiritual consequences because they don't understand spiritual path or spiritual truth at all. So they're heedless of it. So they don't realize the unintended consequences of all this. This is where the Holy Spirit comes in the picture. This alarm just went off at midnight there. How about that? Well, this video is sounding the alarm, isn't it? Through a wonderful constellation of miracles today, the Holy Spirit guided me to this understanding. And again, the Holy Spirit indicates this is coming real soon. It'll catch most of the people unaware. They will simply not have this kind of clarity to recognize it, what's going on, and where to go for remedies, and how, and to match the remedy with the problem. They won't be too confused. They say, no, maybe there must be some way here. So maybe they're going to be nice to me. And, you know, no. There's no more nice in the world here. There's no more nice. The gloves are coming off now. So the nice days are over here. You know, velvet hammer is here. Because the world is in big trouble in terms of the habits. You know, the habits here. And it's hard to change habits. Really difficult. So they aim to do it drastically through drugs. Generation Duh. Drugs, authoritarianism. Generation Damn. Generation Damnation. Drugs. Authoritarianism. Mind control. Knuckleheadness. That's a K. Generation Dunk. Generation Damn Dunk. Generation Damnation. You might call it Generation Damnation. Damnation. Drugs, authoritarianism, and mind control. Okay, well, looks like a duck, walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, swims like a duck. It's a duck. Okay, it's a duck. We better duck the duck. Sidestep the duck. saw these birds on a golf course once. There's so many little birds, and you get near them, they all ran, walked real fast, right into the lake, and they just all plunge right in the lake so easily, you know, and they're just like, there's nothing for them. You know, they just like, I said, oh, how wonderful it would be to like that bird, just be able to plunge into a lake like that, from land to sea like that, with no issues whatsoever. Well, when we're familiar with spiritual truth, we can just plunge right into perfection, the lake of perfection, without any trouble, like a duck jumping in the water. Sidestep the trouble on land. They said, look at that crazy golfer, you know. He's probably going to shank one and hit one of us. Let's get in that lake right away. So they jumped in the lake. I said, ah, there's a tell right there. Nature gives tells. It really does. There are some that are actually, you know, brilliant at that, reading the tells of nature. Some of the indigenous people are very good at that. Some of the augurs of Rome were very good at that, actually, you know, reading the birds, the flight, the various bird things. And they were excellent at it. So it's a type of genius that you can have, reading the tells of nature. You can also read the tells of society, culture, and all this kind of stuff. Doesn't mean, you know, you always get it right. You know, it's not like it's an infallible sort of thing, but it's possible to be very good at it. Yeah, some of the, you know, well, our indigenous history, astonishing what they could be aware of. You just see there's a crow flying over there, just the angles. And they're so knowledgeable about their environment and everything. They say something must have happened here and there and there, and they see another sign, and they somehow, you know, they're able to put together stuff at a distance, and it is, they're very, 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 very astute detectives. Because everything spreads out, has ramifications, you know, if you just become very sensitive, you can really read it very well. It's an open book. So we're reading society here, we're reading social engineering here, and it's quite something. We're getting close now. So just to be in the wow with this is a lot of wow here. This is something that Jesus helped us out with today. Astonishing. Huge leap forward. Huge leap forward today. Now, I didn't really expect another Course in Miracles take notes or something. I mean, the notes I took were the experiences of the day, actually. Those were the notes. It was very just innocent stuff. It just happened during the day, but I just noticed it. I just noticed it. I said, huh, I had some insight there. And then adding them all up, you see, you get this overall tell. So this just, you know, it's a miracle from Jesus today. Because he certainly wants us to be aware of the social engineering that's going on. Because it gets in the way of the spiritual path very severely.